My name is Beatriz Stix-Brunell, and I'm a soloist with the Royal Ballet. One of the reasons I was drawn to the Royal Ballet was because of its, you know, of course, because of its dancers, but also because of its huge repertory. I grew up with 9 boy cousins and an older brother, so we spent a lot of time, you know, running around outside, climbing trees and fishing and, playing games. And I started out initially with gymnastics and diving, and then once I took a ballet class, that kind of captured my interest a bit more. But considering my background, I never really thought I'd, you know, become a professional dancer. So I started my training in New York at the School of American Ballet, and then I went to the Paris Opera Ballet School for a year, and I came back to New York and trained with my teacher, Fabrice Herault, including the ABT School as well. And then I joined Christopher Wheeldon's company, and from there I joined the Royal Ballet. I'm originally from New York, so I grew up there. And I guess when I started becoming very interested in dance was when I saw, I think there were two performances where I began to feel like I could really see myself becoming a professional dancer. When I was at the School of American Ballet, we performed with New York City Ballet a lot. We were in children's ballets, and there was one performance of Mozart Tiana, I remember, when I was around 11. And the curtain came up, and there was like a slightly cold breeze coming from the audience, and the music started, and it was just, I think the music was a very, very big part of why I loved it so much. And then another performance, I guess, was in Harlequinade, where I had danced with a partner for the first time. I was still very young, and that was the first time that I could really connect with a partner on stage, which was very exciting for me. You know, deciding which company to go to is a very important thing, because I was young. I was 17 when I moved to London, and I wanted to go to a company that would nurture a young dancer and that had a lot of strong female dancers that I could also watch and learn from. And one of the reasons I was drawn to the Royal Ballet was because of its, you know, of course, because of its dancers, but also because of its huge repertory. I think any dancer is interested in a company where you can go from Ashton to McGregor to Macmillan to Wheeldon in a day, performing that and rehearsing that in a day. So you have the strong, strong classics, and then all this uncharted territory that you can really explore. And also, the Royal Ballet is a company that's so steeped in tradition as well, and such a beautiful home here. It's kind of an ideal situation. I guess when it came to deciding, you know, to making the move, one of the reasons I was hesitant was because my family is still in the States. And of course I was, you know, it's a big move when you're young, but my dad said to me, you know, if you want to dance in the big leagues, this is what you have to do. And that immediately clicked for me. And London is an amazing, amazing city. So not too different to New York in terms of energy and culture. And there's always so much to do, so much to see here. So it's like living in a little gem box. Yeah, well, I'm a morning person, so I wake up pretty early. I live right around the Opera House, so I just walk to work. I wake up at around 8:30, and I get to work, and I have my morning routine of just warming up my body, stretching, doing a few exercises, and you know, for abs, stabilizing, and just getting ready for class, getting ready to start the very long work day. And then I go into class, which is just a really good warm-up, but also, for me, I see class as well as a really good strengthening opportunity. Because when you're rehearsing so many different types of ballets, it's important to have that one part of your day that's really centralized on technique, and class is a good opportunity for that. So I finish class at 11:45, and then we rehearse from 12 till 5:30 on a show day, or 12 till 6:30 on a non-show day. And we get an hour for lunch, and I also try to incorporate a bit of gym work with my trainer here, Brian Maloney, who is a soloist with the Royal Ballet. And now he, what I work with him on is a lot of abdominals, leg strengthening work and back work for stabilizing, and just keeping, I guess, there's areas that sometimes you can neglect when you're working. So we work on muscles that I sometimes can get a little bit out. And I also do gyrotonics with Fiona downstairs, which is basically for just keeping the movement in the back, which can get a bit tight and stiff. So getting the circular movement in the back is really helpful for just keeping the joints nice and loose. We're lucky here because the opera house has everything under one roof. So I get physio and massage here whenever I need it, and everything is provided for, which is excellent. And then we have a show at 7:30. If we don't have a show, then I go home and unwind. We have one day off, which is Sunday, which is usually, for most people, is usually the day to kind of do laundry and go to the market and do everything that you don't really get to do during the week because it's so busy. When we don't have shows at night, it's because this job is, you know, very high pressure physically and mentally. It's just very exhausting. I like to kind of switch off a bit and do something very different. I like to read a lot when I get home, maybe see a movie that I've missed out on. I've always liked doing collages, which is, you know, you can kind of organize little, cut up little pieces from magazines, little words, little strips, color in, and kind of arrange them however you want. So it's a little bit like dancing in a way, just on a piece of paper. And I've always been interested in reading and writing poetry. So my grandfather used to write poetry as well, so we would kind of do that together, and I still enjoy doing that now, just finding ways to put words together in hopefully a beautiful way. So yeah, that's what I do. Alice was the first principal role I did with the company when I was 19. It was my second season, and I found out with about 4 weeks' notice. One of the dancers had gotten injured, and I was covering the role. And so I had pretty much about 3 weeks to get ready before I was on stage. And that was, of course, you can't really dream of anything more exciting. It was the first time that I was doing a big character role on stage, and the first time I really had to figure out how to prepare for a role like that. So, of course, I reread the book. Watch the old film and just kind of lived, breathed Alice every day. That was my day in the studio with Chris Wheeldon and Jackie Barrett. And I think getting to be coached on so deeply and so specifically in a role like that was very exciting, because you constantly just think of different ways that you can ingrain Alice into your own character, into your own body, find ways that your character is like hers and bring that out in the role. And it was not only just focusing obviously on the technique of the ballet, which is difficult because you have to sustain the, you know, a three-act ballet, even when you're tired. You can't lose the character, you can't lose the footwork. So not just going into that, you know, with your physically, but also character-wise, you know, just maintaining in little areas where it's easy for the character to maybe dwindle, trying to keep that alive. Well, I first worked with Chris when I was 14, and then I joined his company, Morphosis. So I've known Chris for a long time, and he's a very special person. He he has a wonderful sense of humor. So in the studio, it's not only very intense, of course, because, you know, you're creating and you're, he knows exactly what he wants, but also we have a great time. We have a great time. And he gives a lot of wonderful visualizations. In terms of, I remember once I was doing polyphonia, and he asked me to do a contraction in one of the steps, which I was having some difficulties with, and he told me to think of my back being like a spider getting stuck down a drain. And automatically, it kind of made sense exactly what he was talking about, and I was able to incorporate the movement into my body. He knows exactly what he wants, and it's very exciting to try to, you know, put what he envisions into the studio and onto the stage. In an existing role, you know, you have a lot of history behind you. You have a lot of people who've done the role. So you can do a lot of research. You see different things that people have done from past performances, what you know you want to do, what you know you don't want to do. And in a lot of the times in an existing choreography, the choreographer is no longer around. So you're not really getting things from the horse's mouth. It's more almost through an interpreter. But you can still, of course, make the role your own. And it's really exciting to be able to kind of try to, you know, make the role refreshing as a new person. But when you're creating the role, you know, it's designed for you. Some of the best times you can have in the studio is creating a role, because it's an intimate exchange between two artists, where the choreographer knows your body, knows what suits you, what doesn't suit you, and he's creating something especially for you, for your needs, for your, basically, he knows what's difficult for you, so if he wants to challenge you, he'll put something in there that you know will be tricky, but somehow you make it work. If he wants you to just dance and use all your strong points, then he'll just give you something where you can abandon and let go. And then I think you also, it's an exchange where you work so closely together that you run into problems together, and then you have to find the solutions together. So it's kind of putting a puzzle and creating it along the way, and being the first one doing it, you can do it however you want. So that's really exciting. I first worked with Wayne when I first joined the company, actually. And he's really fascinating to work with, because he's a real visionary, so he knows exactly what he wants, and he's very intense. And it's pretty much putting your body into a different dance language, really. It's almost like a mathematical equation when you're working in the studio with him. It's really incredible, because his mind works in shapes almost. There's patterns of geometry and inversing, reversing, counting backwards, going in different directions. And when I think about, you know, his mind, sometimes I think it almost works like, you know, like laser beams shooting everywhere. It works so quickly. But what I find really interesting is not just obviously working one-on-one with him in the studio, but taking a step back and outside and watching him create, watching him with his dancers. Because you can tell he's having so much fun just envisioning something and pushing his dancers to the limit and seeing what he wants kind of come to life in the studio. Obviously, you do work with a lot of different partners, just in that's the nature of the company. But what's nice is that when you're working on a bigger piece or a full-length ballet, you establish a relationship with your partner. And a partnership is very important, because that's kind of when you have to work so closely with each other and create an atmosphere on the stage. It's really important to have someone that you can connect with, that you feel safe with, that you know will listen to you, and will harmonize with you well. Because when you're in the studio and you're working with someone, you know instantly that it feels right and that it feels just natural, and that you can say anything or ask them anything and they'll be there for you. You know, the eye contact, the touch, the physicality of it all has to be there, because I've had, you know, both ends of the spectrum. I've had really, really great partners, and I've had partners that have, you know, not been very good. Because if someone's not invested or not completely there, it doesn't translate well. And, you know, it unfortunately creates for not so pleasant experience. So for example, there can be someone who's, you know, physically not quite suited to you, who could be much shorter than you, but if their personality and if their work ethic meshes well with you, you can create something really special. Whereas you can be with someone who proportionally looks wonderful with you but isn't all there, and you can't make anything happen like that. I think in the dance world, there's a lot of external energy and a lot of crazy things going on around you, but at the end of the day, you know, you have to take care of your body and yourself and what you feel is right for you. So I think if you work intelligently in that respect and focus on your strengths, your weaknesses, and finding someone that can be a mentor for you and can, you know, will give you honest feedback and honest advice. My family they're an academic family, so they don't have anything to do with the dance world. So I think it's nice to have a close relationship with my family that is grounded, and we can talk about a lot of things outside of the dance world, I think that's been a strong point over Skype these past few years. Definitely is having them there. You have Sleeping Beauty, Manon, Rite of Spring by, you know, Macmillan, which is almost tribal dancing. You have Wealden ballets, McGregor ballets, Balanchine ballets. You have, you know, Pina Bausch, for example, Twyla Tharp, which is more jazzy, more Broadway. You have so much range. And that's part of the excitement of this career, is you get the luxury of not just focusing on, the luxury and the challenge of not just focusing on one specific style, but getting down and dirty and, you know, rolling on the floor and then wearing a tutu the next day. So you can do all of those in you can do five different ballets in one day. There's really nothing better than that, and that's what we get here.